bits of bone or any feathers, then she will actually regurgitate that tomorrow morning in a little pellet called a casting. And something you've probably heard of owls bringing up pellets. Well, you actually find most birds actually bring up pellets. All birds of prey do it. Gulls do it. Crows do it. Blackbirds and starlings, they'll bring up little pellets with all the skins and seeds of the fruits that they've been eating, all the berries, anything they can't digest from that fruit, they'll bring up in a little pellet. Lots of little insect-eating birds do it as well. Any insect shells that they can't digest, they bring up in these little casts, these little pellets. Now, I said at the start there that Malaya here was a lugger falcon. In actual fact, I slightly misled you. She's not actually a pure lugger falcon. She is, in fact, what's known as a hybrid falcon. She's a cross between a lugger falcon and a saker falcon. Living next door to her, you'll see a pure saker falcon, which gives you an idea, kind of looking at the difference between the two. And she looks and behaves far more like a lugger falcon than she does the saker falcon. Now, the idea of crossing two different falcon species is to try and get the best qualities of two birds rolled into one. Interesting one, right? Off you go then, Zulu. Now, you'll notice in flight, she has virtually no tail. She's got a tiny, tiny, short tail for her size. Now, this is a natural feature of the Bataloon eagle. And the idea behind it is, well, come to the main theory behind why they have a short tail. But what it means for them is they cannot actually use their tail as a steering system or braking system like other birds of prey do. So instead, they use their body weight to actually steer or to change direction or to slow down. And this is what gives them the name Bataloure. Bataloure is from a French word, referring to a tightened stretch of wings out and lift the crown of feathers on the back of her head right up, and she'll kind of make snorting, hissing noises. And that snake recognises that it's in danger, so it takes a defensive posture. It lifts its head up, threatening to strike at the eagle. Now, the snake doesn't want to waste its venom, so it takes its defensive posture first. But the eagle then does something which sounds rather daft. She starts to slap the snake around the face with her wingtips. Now, what she's trying to do is she's trying to...
legs for an eagle as well, so
they do look kind of quite comical and quite awkward on the ground.
Go on, go get it.
Now, unfortunately for the Bataloure eagle, their future in the wild is very uncertain at the moment. Those of you who are here at the first show, I told you all about the plight of the vultures. Well, just to kind of give a brief overview for the folk that weren't here, vultures in the wild are actually in severe decline. And all the reasons that they're disappearing are man-made. Electrocution of power lines, finding poison baits put out from other animals, putting massive pressure on wild vulture populations. The Bataloure eagle is in exactly the same boat, because they are mostly a scavenger out in the wild. The Bataloure eagles may be 10 years old before they start to breed.
Country, but they're not actually native. They were brought in by a landowner a couple of hundred years ago. He thought they were quite a cute little owl, and he would like to have some on his property. So he brought back a dozen breeding pairs, and their numbers just took off from there.
Come on, missus.
Usually cause quite a lot of problems for the local ecosystem, taking places where other predators would usually be, and there's always adverse effects. Except with the little owl there weren't so many, because it found a niche that no one else really had adapted for in this country. They actually quite like living in rabbit burrows, and at this point there's myxocytosis and everything, so rabbit burrows were free to be occupied. Feed on sort of large to medium sized insects, beetles, things like that, and there's not a great deal of local wildlife that does feed on this kind of thing, and so she did quite well in this country. There you go, missed it completely. And she has a close cousin, the burrowing owl, which is, believe it or not, smaller than her. They actually make a lifestyle from living in not rabbit holes but gopher holes, and as far as we know, they're the only owl that uses bait.
And a group of vultures called New World Vultures. because they are from the New World, which is the Americas. And the Old World vultures, those from Africa, Europe and Asia, those guys who are here at the first show, met Gandalf, who is an Old World vulture. Now, the two groups of vultures are completely unrelated. Now, the Old World vultures are apparently more closely related to eagles, which you can quite believe. But these guys are apparently more closely related to the crane family. Personal little theory about turkey vultures and their origins. And bear in mind, this is my own personal theory. To me, the turkey vulture is far more pigeon-like than anything else. There are lots of things very pigeon-like about them. If you look at the way she was pottering around on the ground there, the way she kind of waddles about, it's very pigeon-like. Her feet are broad and flat, like a pigeon's. The colour of her feet, no member of the vulture family has coloured feet other than the turkey vulture. No member of the crane family has red legs. But virtually every member of the pigeon family has red feet. The kind of bottle blue sheen to her feathers, something you don't see members of the crane family or the vulture family, but you see very regularly in the pigeon family. A lot of have a look at the length of the neck. That's for reaching all the favourite juicy bits first. It's a bit like having the longest arm at a buffet table. Get your favourite bits first. Also, look at her neck. It's not completely bald. She has a layer of kind of soft, fuzzy feathers all the way across her neck. And this is all about keeping warm at night and also reflecting the heat of the sun away from her skin, preventing her from getting sunburned. There we go. Sorry? She's not at all, she's absolutely, certainly nature didn't build this bird to be a supermodel, but they were built to be a very specific purpose, a purpose they're essential for. Right, Gandalf, we're just about run out of food for you now, so we're going to get rid of you. Right, come on in. Right, come on in. Right, guys, give Gandalf a great big round of applause. Come on.